former EU Commissioner for Environment.
Okay, good morning to everybody, dear friends. I hope it's working. Can you please confirm?
We can hear and see you just well. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot. I'm really glad that I can speak today on the European Green Deal, on the opportunities of international cooperation, and in particular to draw your attention on something which was just recently adopted. So to put everything in the perspective, I'm currently co-chairing United Nations International Resource Panel, which is a kind of a sister organization of IPCC, which we know better, of IPBS, which of course next year in China will be having a special attention. And we are International Resource Panel. So a panel which is dealing with management of the natural resources. So a kind of so we have approximately 40 scientists on board from all around the world, also from China. We have a steering committee, European Union and China both are playing quite a visible and important role. And we have a secretariat which is located in Paris, a relatively small one. And our task is science policy interface. And of course, we have also many of the strategic partners. So a lot of the things which I will be saying, it's actually based on the knowledge which is created there. The thing which I think it's most important that we start finally to understand is that we are the first generation actually, so which is for the first time in human history living in a socio-ecological space of planetary scope. So it means that we are more interconnected and interdependent than ever, and that our individual and collective responsibility has thus enormously increased. When we try to analyze the questions which are related with the state of environment, economy, and so on, we are normally focusing on state and impact. So whenever we say climate change, it's actually the result of something. When we say biodiversity loss, it's the impact of some things which are caused by the drivers and pressures. So whenever we really want to address the core reasons, and we have to address the core reasons, we are talking about human behavior. And human behavior, in particular when it comes to how we actually take care for ourselves, as you know, it's called economics. So how we use the resources, it's actually a connecting element between the two sides. And why this is important? Because if we address the problems at the core, of course, the policies are different as if we would address them at the state and impact. That means that our focus more or less should be on how we will reorganize our economy. But let us go to the year 2000. It was definitely a kind of a wake-up call for the future we want. We are reaching the tipping points, so we are leaving the safe operating space across multiple Earth systems. We all see that we are in economic reset and economies are in the lockdown and governments are releasing the biggest stimulus packages in recent memory. Multilateralism, it's on the test bench, so the prospects for international cooperation are rather limited. Also, the climate activism has got a renewed vigor, but probably the most important, at least from the European side, that it's a paradigm change in European politics, which we can see through the European Green Deal. So let me focus a bit on that. The Commission priorities, which were set by President von der Leyen in July 2019, were European Green Deal, an economy that works for people, Europe fit for the digital age.
I'll interrupt you for one second. I just would like to say we cannot see your slides. If you have any slides you'd like to share, they are not up on the screen at the moment.
That was exactly what I was asking you at the beginning. Just a second. So I have to go back here. Screen share. So it was not working at the beginning. So is it now there?
Yes, we see them just clearly now. Thank you.
Okay. Now I will continue from here. So not to go to the beginning. So Commission priorities, European Green Deal, an economy that works for people. Europe fit for the digital age, protecting our European way of life, then stronger Europe in the world and the new push for European democracy. What is actually the real novelty which we can see and which was brought by the European Green Deal, and it's important to remember? When I was still the member of the Commission, I have to be quite honest that economy and environment were always seen very much in contradiction. With the European Green Deal, there is clear acknowledgement that environment and economic goals are not in contradiction. On the contrary, if you do not regard enough, if you don't take into account how you treat natural resources, actually you limit your economic development. So it aims to transform the European Union into fair and prosperous society with a modern, resource efficient and competitive economy, where there are no net emissions of greenhouse gases in 2050, and where economic growth is decoupled from the resource use. Special attention is also given to social considerations of the transition. It is pretty clear to everybody that transition, environmental transition, will more or less fly or fall on the basis of how the social part will be organized, and in particular, how the most vulnerable groups of people will be addressed. Which is the general orientation? It aims to protect, conserve, enhance the European Union natural capital, protect the health, well-being of citizens from environment-related risks and impacts, and at the same time, this transition must be just and inclusive. It is said in the Green Deal that it is an integral part of the European Commission strategy to implement UN 2030 Agenda and the SDGs, and that the communication is just the initial roadmap of key policies and measures. All EU actions and policies will have to contribute to Green Deal objectives. We have to rethink policies for clean energy, supply across the economy, industry, production and consumption, large-scale infrastructure, transport, food and agriculture, construction, taxation, and social benefits. All that are quotes from the European Green Deal. So when you are talking about European Green Deal, you should not understand it as a communication which was released in December, but the whole list of documents which followed suit after that. And this is, in essence, the logic of the Green Deal and implementation. Green Deal is based on the circular economy. And circular economy should be seen as an instrument for delivering decoupling of economic growth from resource use and environmental impacts. I will say a bit more about that later. But also as a part of the bigger picture of economic, societal, and cultural transformation needed to deliver sustainable development goals. This is the most famous outline, which I'm pretty sure that many of you have seen. It was done by Ellen MacArthur Foundation. It's actually saying that the circular economy, it's a system in which you try to keep various kinds of resources in production and consumption process as long as possible, and also keep their value as high as possible to keep the economic attention of policy of economic actors that the system is actually attractive. So in the first place, it's about how to reduce the consumption of natural resources. And recycling is, of course, also part of the circular economy. But if I can be blunt, recycling is the worst of the good, because whenever you recycle, you have already used the natural resources. So when we talk about decoupling concept, we basically talk that well-being, growth of well-being and growth of economic activity in the future needs to be decoupled from the growth of the resource use. And both needs to be decoupled from the environmental impacts. Because if we do not do that, we will simply hit the walls which are caused by side effects, climate change, biodiversity loss, pollution, and others which are connected to the use of the natural resources. Now, I will be talking about something which goes actually a step further from the Green Deal. We have just a few days ago adopted by the Club of Rome and Systemic something which is called the System Change Compass, implementing European Green Deal in time of recovery. What we are basically saying there is that ambition of the European Green Deal is extremely high. So it's setting zero net emissions by 2050, as you have already heard. It's also clearly setting the goal of decoupling of growth from resource use. It's acknowledging the need for fair and just transition, and also aims at strongly interlinked and mutually reinforcing policy recommendations. But implementation is quite uncertain. Why? Because it does not sufficiently address drivers and pressures that cause the environmental damage, because it does not offer a systemic perspective to guide some decision making, and of course also because implementation is put at extra risk due to the COVID-19 recovery. So what we have proposed, it's actually something which is mapping and envisaging the system in service of planet and people, which derives system level orientations towards desired state, and which charts pathways towards the prosperity and well-being within the planetary boundaries. So not that we would be saying at all that Green Deal is something which we should not praise. On the contrary, we think finally we have something around which we can gather our forces, but I will just try to explain where we would need to focus if we would really want to have this, the change done. This was in a way acknowledged also by the President von der Leyen, September 16, in her State of the Union address, where she was saying that systemic modernization across our economy, society, and industry is needed, and where she was clearly saying that our current levels of consumption of raw materials, energy, water, food, and land use are not sustainable, so that we need to change how we treat nature, how we produce and consume, live and work, eat and heat, travel and transport. So it's actually a new investment plan for Europe. So she has, by the way, provided the foreword to the System Change Compass report, which I will very quickly explain. It is based on natural resource logic, natural resource optic. Why? Because the core limiting factor of human well-being and also our economic development in the future will actually be natural resources and environmental things. So natural resources are kind of a bridge between economy and competitiveness on one hand, and the climate change, biodiversity loss, pollution, and health implications on the other. How we have actually designed the compass? So we have 10 principles, which I will very quickly explain later, which are then connected with the three system level policy orientations for each compass principle. So 30 core policy orientations, which any policymaker would need to follow in the future. This is then linked to 8 economic ecosystems, which again will be explained. And each of them is connected to 3 to 5 specific ecosystem orientations. And finally, we have on the basis of that design 50 plus most important development opportunities of the future. So this is actually linking very much the macroeconomic story with very concrete investment opportunities, which are, according to us, the most important directions where we should put our attention. First, redefining prosperity, embracing social fairness for real prosperity, redefining natural resource use. Prosperity should be decoupled from natural resource use, redefining progress, meeting societal needs as a purpose of a model based on economic ecosystems, redefining matrix, performance measurement updated. So we have to move from GDP and we have to start taking into account all the costs also in the companies related to environment and health, redefining competitiveness, resource optimization through digitalization at the heart of European competitiveness, redefining incentives, show the real value of social and natural capital. Currently, it's more or less that production capital or financial capital is overvalued and overrewarded. Human capital is undervalued and underrewarded, and natural capital to a large extent is not valued at all. Redefining consumption from owing to using. We need mobility, we don't need cars. Then redefining finance, the facilitator of the transition. Redefining governance, a systemic approach to governance influenced by science. And finally, redefining leadership, intergenerational agreement through new forms of leadership. All of that, as I have mentioned, have three principal compass policy orientations. I will just mention one as an example, which is connected to redefining prosperity. So we do believe that policy attention should be rebalanced from only putting attention to income creation and wealth creation to income and wealth distribution, and that we ensure that economic transition contributes to equality and to social fairness, guaranteeing the universal basic services and also minimum levels of income. We should also set the conditions for social acceptance of the necessary transition. If we want to introduce the full cost in our products, this is absolute necessary precondition. And we have to replace part of the income-based taxes with resource-based taxes to address both resources as well as social policy targets. And then nine of them are following in the same suit. Then we are coming to economic ecosystems. So this relatively abstract part of policymaking is now connected with a very concrete part of our economy. We are defining eight economic ecosystems. Why we are calling them ecosystems, like in nature? Because first of all, they are interconnected like the environmental ecosystems. And second, because a lot of economic solutions can actually be mirrored from the solutions which are done in nature. So four of them, which are most related to resource-intensive human needs, is nutrition, so healthy food, housing, built environment, mobility, and finally, the rest of the consumer goods, like computers, like clothes you are wearing, and so on. These are basically more or less all the human ecosystems, so needs related, which are causing the major consumption of natural resources. And then we have identified also four core economic ecosystems which are helping delivering these societal needs: nature-based solutions, energy, circular materials, so the whole circular economy is actually very much connected in, and finally, innovation, which best represented in digitalization, information and processing. So for each of them, again, we are proposing free policy orientations. For example, this is the case for mobility: reduce the need for motorized trips through, and then we are listing them, prioritize medium of transport that it's easiest to electrify, maximize utilization through, and so on. So I will not continue, just that you get an idea that I would attract your attention to that, and probably you will take it in your hands. Finally, we have proposed also 50 industrial champions, so 50 major economic opportunities, which are actually opportunities which are linked with the logic which is previously described. So with economic ecosystems and also with the compass: healthy food, built environment, intermodal mobility, consumer goods, nature-based solutions, energy, circular materials, and finally information and processing. So this is a kind of a overview of the major and most attractive investments needed for a sustainable future. They are very much in line also with the European partnerships which were identified by innovation and research part of the European Commission and would, according to them, need to be addressed in the future. Finally, if I just summarize everything to you, so here we have a compass with their clear definitions: eight economic ecosystems, then 50 plus economic opportunities. Then each of the compass has three system level policy orientations, each of economic ecosystems, 3 to 5 specific economic ecosystem policy orientations. And finally, each one of the development opportunities is nicely described. So this is actually European Green Deal implementation system roadmap, which is very much impacting the renovation wave, which European institutions today are very much talking about, and also the new industrial policy, which is currently in development. Dear friends, European Green Deal and COVID-19 are actually very much connected. The basic lessons are that we are currently facing globally three crises. Two are acute: health and social economic crisis, because the economies have in large part of the world shut down. But there is also a crisis with the deeper roots, a chronic crisis of globalization and economic transformation. And the latter has been feeding actually the climate change, the income inequality, and it's rapidly leading also to the potential massive unemployment. Some are saying that the world after COVID-19 will not be the same. I do not agree. I think it will be more or less exactly the same. We will hopefully just better understand it. Very likely, unfortunately, the frequency and severity of health-related outbreaks, climate-related extreme weather events will in the future increase. So we need to rethink the way we are managing the risks as individuals, collectively, as private companies, as policymakers, locally, globally. So we need to collaborate more to build resilient societies and to be better prepared. Role of the science in policymaking should increase. I think this is one of the lessons which we have all learned from both from the climate change and COVID. and precautionary principle, which is, by the way, written in European Union treaties, maybe we should try to better implement it in practice because it can save lives and jobs, of course, accordingly. I do see European Green Deal and post-COVID recovery as two sides of the same coin. Why? Because the economic policy, which is actually designed in European Green Deal and related documents, it's actually already the most convincing competitiveness policy of the European Union. We are, like China, very much import dependent on energy and on many of the natural resources. Second, because European Green Deal already provides quite convincing answers when it comes to the questions which are related to reconsidering globalization effects and globalization chains, economic chains. And third, because the European Green Deal and post-COVID-19 call for intergenerational solidarity and agreement, we are terribly indebting future generations. In environmental sense, which is the clearly, so we are depleting natural capital, which is actually indebting future generations when it comes to environment. But now with the new economic packages, which we are adopting financial, we are additionally somehow putting them into future financial debt. So the minimum what is required is that we leave the future generations with a better world than it's the one in which we are currently living. COVID-19 is also providing the necessary missing urgency to the European Green Deal and climate-related financial efforts. At least in European Union, we have currently practically on the table doubled amount almost of the European budget, which is an excellent opportunity that we actually use it in a proper way to address also the systemic measures and systemic questions. And finally, both are actually calling for new approach in governance, in particular when it comes to global level cooperation. So more cooperation is needed. Transition to a more sustainable economy and society, it's simply unavoidable. Humans are supposed to be intelligent, and it's high time to prove it. So we have to fix a broken compass. Will that be easy? When Albert Einstein was once asked why the mankind was so intelligent to discover the structure of the atom, but was not able to devise the political means to keep the atom from the destroying us, he replied, "This is simple, my friend. It's because politics is more difficult than physics." This story of natural resource management, circular economy, which I'm sharing with you, is pretty much about physics, because we are to a large extent denying physical laws. And unfortunately, it's true. It depends a lot on political will and how we will actually join the forces to address those questions. We need more circularity, if I can say so, also in our cooperation, in global governance. So we need to share sovereignty more than to owe sovereignty. And Europe understood after the Second World War that very well. And not that we would not have quite a lot of problems like anybody has today, but still we do understand what value that brings to our cooperation. And that's why we do believe in multilateralism, and we believe that cooperation is the thing which we need in the world. China and Europe are extremely strong partners, and our cooperation, also when it comes to greening the economy, it's essential. One of the ideas which I'm defending and promoting through the International Resource Panel, it's potential convention on natural resource management, where we would agree the rules, where we would agree to everything which is connected to how to change our economies, that we would create a level footing system through which we would actually organize a responsible management of the natural resources. Johann Wolfgang Goethe nicely summarized that by saying, "Knowing it's not enough, we must apply. Willing it's not enough, we must do." And European Commissioner Thierry Breton last week very nicely said it in one of the occasions. The real problem is, do we have the courage to do what it takes? And for those who are still doubting that this is the right thing to do, that's my final advice, which is coming from Professor Guy McPherson from Arizona University in the United States. If you think that economy is more important than environment and health, try holding your breath while counting your money. Thank you for your attention. I will unfortunately not be able to stay with you till the end because I have another conference actually in 50 minutes. but thank you for inviting me.
Thank you so much for your presentation, Mr. Poticnik. Thank you for quite the concrete and the ideas for the different models and your takes on this whole circular economy. We have to stick go fast towards to the next item on our program, and that will be with Mr. Sebastian Paquot, who is the head of environment section at the EU delegation in Beijing, and I'll just be finding your presentation here. So that should be this one, yeah. Okay. There we go.
So thanks a lot. Thank you to the organizer, Your Excellencies. Thanks a lot for the invitation. Before starting, let me just say that it's very much of an honor to speak after Commissioner Poticnik. Is very positively remembered in Brussels for his wisdom and vision. Of course, the counter side of that is that I only have 5 minutes to go through my presentation, but I will do my best to run you through and to try to explain the key lines of the Green Deal, which is, as expressed by Commissioner Poticnik, one step into a transition which is very much needed. And as every transition, it comes with challenge and opportunities, and I will try to indicate those to you today. So, very shortly, because it has been explained clearly by the previous speaker, the Green Deal do not come from nowhere. It comes from key trends which are there. Population is increasing, middle class is growing, calling for more resource consumption, more people living in cities, increasing amount of litters, including plastics. And this leads to several crises. A crisis on the biodiversity, we are facing a mass extinction, and of course, climate crisis, with an increase of planet temperature. If we don't change our behavior, we'll end up with +3 degrees, and we know that it will lead to additional natural disasters. And I don't even mention the ongoing health crisis. So we have to do something, that's pretty clear, and that was also understood by the EU leaders when this new commission entered into duty. And as indicated before, the first priority of this commission was to come up with a European Green Deal. One very important message that needs to be hammered over and over is that the European Green Deal is not one more environmental policy. It's really a comprehensive growth strategies that intend to, yes, bring the EU to climate neutrality, but also to protect nature, human life, animals, and to cut pollutions. But at the same time, to help EU companies to become world leaders, to develop their competencies in clean product, technology, clean energy, and to boost our economies through those clean practices. And then finally, it's also intent to do this all together in a just and inclusive transition, bringing everybody along. If we have to summarize the Green Deal on one slide, this would be the slide. You can see that it comprises 8 key pillars. I will try to go to most of them today, but in the time I have, I will not go in depth to all of them. I will rather focus on the left side of the screen, which is more related to the economy. It goes about first the vision of achieving a climate neutral Europe, then the energy parts, then the part addressing industry, circular economy, the opportunity of building and renovating our buildings. I will say words on the smart mobility, but I will not present specific slides on the right side, which is also extremely important. It concerns the zero pollution strategy, which is in the making, toxic-free environment. The Commission came with a new chemical strategy, which is absolutely important. Then the strategy that was proposed in May to preserve biodiversity. And on the same day, the farm-to-fork strategy that intends to improve the sustainability of the food system. We know that food system contributes to a lot of environmental problems. It also creates health problems in Europe, and we have to address those. And finally, I will give a last word on the financing of this transition, which is obviously key. So if we look at what we can call the long-term vision, which is achieving this climate neutrality in 2050, we can say that the first milestone has been put. The European Commission has proposed a climate law, and the objective is to enshrine into law this target so that it cannot be changed so easily in 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. It's really a long-term vision that has to be supported by a strong law. But we also know that to achieve this climate neutrality, we have to take some very serious milestone on the medium and short term. And that's why it was announced officially on Saturday at the Climate Action Summit that the EU will commit to this decrease of minus 55% greenhouse gas emission by 2030, so within 10 years. And that's quite a significant improvement. It will put us more than halfway in our journey towards carbon neutrality. But of course, it necessitates quite a drastic revision of all the way we produce, consume, and live. This will be made through several legislative change. I will not go into all the details today. I would simply also mention that we want to avoid carbon leakage. Carbon leakage means companies that are in Europe and that want to leave because of carbon pricing increase. This will be avoided through the carbon border adjustment mechanism. And we'll also work on the adaptation because, unfortunately, yes, the temperature will rise, hopefully to a limited extent. So very briefly, if we focus on the climate side, you can see on that chart that three key building blocks need to be addressed in priority. Power, the yellow line, industry, the blue line, and transport, the brown line. All those three together represent 75% of greenhouse gas emission in Europe, quite a significant potential. So if we look first at energy, energy in fact represents altogether, if you take production consumption, it's 75% of greenhouse gas emission. So we need to act on energy. And the first things to do, obviously, is to decarbonize the energy sector by boosting renewable energy. And we know that there are a lot of opportunities, including in offshore winds. Then we need to integrate all those sources of renewable energy through the grid. And for that, we need a smart grid that can help to integrate the variation of renewables into a stable grid. We also need to promote energy efficiency. That can be done on products, and for that we have the eco-design directive that put conditions for the placing on the market of any kind of product, not only on energy, but also on repairability, in line with what Commissioner Poticnik said on circular economy a few minutes before. But energy efficiency can also work on production process and on buildings. Then we also need to develop alternative energy carrier and storage, such as hydrogen and also batteries, where we can store the energy during the variation of renewable energy production. And finally, there's also the intention to launch a massive renovation wave for the building sector. And the intention here is to double the renovation rate of EU buildings to reach 35 million of buildings renovated by 2030. You might know that the building in Europe are relatively old, so the potential there is also gigantic. I think it's a good illustration of the challenge, but also the opportunity for the business and for the economy to put its resources at a place where they would really make a positive difference for the people, for the inhabitants, for the economy, and for the planet. Then if we move quickly to the other part, which is the industry, it's clear that the industry has to evolve also. It represents 20% of EU emission. It consumes a lot of resource. In fact, the extraction of resource due to industrial consumption has tripled from 70 to 2017. So we need to move toward a cleaner and more circular industry and economy. For that, we have the industrial strategy that was adopted in March. It focuses on two key pillars, digitalization and greening. And if we could look a bit more in depth, we have the Circular Economy Action Plan, which was proposed on March 2020. It's the second Circular Economy Action Plan. The first one has been adopted in 2015, has been fully implemented by then, the 34 actions. And this new one will, the implementation has just started. We'll have also new legislation on batteries to make them more circular and sustainable. This has been proposed a few days ago in December 2020. There will be also an initiative to address waste. You know that we have quite some stringent recycling targets in Europe. Those will be further increased. And we are also working on more breakthrough technologies, like, for example, making clean steel, which means zero carbon steel by 2030. If you allow me to spend a little bit of time on a circular economy, let me just explain that the final goal is to make sustainable product the norm in the EU through a new sustainable product policy. This product policy means new legislation and regulation that will regulate the placing on the market of products, just like eco-design do. Eco-design so far was mostly focusing on energy requirements. The evolution will be that the product put on the market will also be repairable and easily recyclable. It means that there will be conditions for ensuring that the repaired parts are available, that the product can be opened and repaired, to avoid that consumer have to dispose their product each time that they break off too quickly. This will also lead to new rights for consumer, which will have a right to repair, and same for public buyers. The Circular Economy Action Plan will focus on key value chain. You might remember that we did that already with plastic in the past. Now we will address batteries and vehicles, packaging, textile, construction, food, and electronics, and of course, we will keep working on plastics. This is not something we want to do alone, and that's why I'm always happy to talk about that in China, because our value chain are so intricate that it would be stupid to take decision in the EU without trying to reach an agreement with our partners with whom we exchange resource, finished products, and raw materials. Finally, I'm speeding up, but I'm trying to catch up. I would like to address the mobility aspect. Few key elements to highlight the objective of this mobility strategy. You can see on the left side that transport still represents 70% of emission in the EU, followed by civil aviation and waterborne transport. Therefore, we need to act with some priorities. So to give you an idea, because the strategy is much broader than that, but some objective by 2030, we aim to have on the market 30 million zero emission cars that will be of course powered by 3 million charging points. We want to have 100 European cities climate neutral. It means that in those cities, we'll need to further increase zero emission vehicle and transport possibilities. We want to have high-speed traffic to double, and we also want to get rid of carbon emission for travel that will be lower than 500 kilometers. It means that the train, again, will have to increase importance. And finally, a little bit of a vision for what will be the marine vessel of the future and the aircraft of the future. We expect them to be carbon neutral by 2030 for marines and to have zero emission large aircraft by 2035. So just to give a vision of what the future could look like, again, probably a lot of challenge, but also a lot of opportunities for those which will be the first movers in those areas. So I have no time to come back on that. The intention was to give a little bit of words on the right part. Keep in mind simply that it's very important too. And I will finish with the money, because to achieve all that, we need money. And to some extent, it's extremely positive to see that the EU decided to bring such a high EU recovery plan and to dedicate a large part of it to green priorities. So the EU recovery plan plus the EU budget will make a total of 1,124 billions that will strongly support the green priorities. In fact, 30% will be dedicated to finance actions positive for the climate. This is not the only aspect. The resource that will feed into this budget will also come partly from green resources. So will be a tax on plastic, which is not recycled. There will be also a fraction on the money collected by the EU ETS that will feed into the EU budget and more. Tools such as the Invest EU will also support the Green Deal objective, and the EIB, so the European International Bank, will dedicate 50% of its investment by 25 to green projects. So you see that the EU is not only ambitious, it's also extremely consistent. It places its money where it places its worth. And I think that together with China and other partners, we have a huge opportunity to initiate this transition that was called by Commissioner Poticnik, and clearly that we all need if we want to live in a more sustainable way in the future. I'll leave you on that, but thanks a lot for your attention.
Thank you so much to Mr. Paquot for sharing with us sort of the European perspective on this whole green and circular topic that we're having today. We're really getting around a lot of different corners, and from the European perspective,